Have fast Corvettes and all that, but most likely he had the fastest and the nicest horse that was around in his day. Yeah. So most likely Absalom had all his trust in his mule that it would not leave him. But see, now there's a difference between the mule of sin and the mule of mercy. You say, what are you talking about? The mule of sin will run out from under you and leave you hanging by your head. Yeah. But the mule of mercy is the one that Absalom was on and kept turning aside. That way Balaam would not be killed. Yeah. And so I began to think about that, and I began to do research on it. And I began to look up about mules and horses. And there was in 2005, there was a 14-year-old girl went and bought a horse and a mule, and she was going to raise it and train it to be a racing horse. And she had so much trust in this horse that she did not think that this horse is going to kill me. But in 2005, that little girl was out there, and the horse kicked her in the brain, causing her to die and be killed from the brain injury. So the horse was sold to another farmer. In 2010, a 37-year-old man bought the horse. Now most likely they should have thought, hey, this horse had killed a little girl before, so he should have known, I can't fully trust this horse. But the same thing happened as he was standing behind it, fixing the stirrups and stuff. The horse kicked him and caused him to die from internal bleeding. And so the same horse in 2011, a 32-year-old man, the same horse was up there and was feeding it, and the horse got mad and turned and kicked the man in the head. That is terrible thing. Someone should have learned further down the line, you cannot trust this horse. But you know what happened? A 3-year-old little girl went down to the pen where her daddy was just killed by. And not only did the horse kill the daddy, but it kicked the little girl, knocking her senseless, and no one found her because she had no mom. And several days went by and she died also. The same mule killed two people. And so in 2018, on January 24th, the same mule was out in a field with a 60-year-old old man who he rode out to his pasture. When he got off, the horse got down and began to kick him and trample him over and over and over. What are you saying? You can't, once something happens to someone else, you should look at it and say, I cannot go down the road they're going. You can't do the things they're doing. It should be that in our everyday life as a Christian, we can say, well, I've seen where they messed up. I won't do that. But no, we go right back to the same horse, go right back down doing the same thing. And I'm going to preach, but I got to lay a foundation. And so they went on down. And so the horse now had been killed.
Yeah.
Because after it killed all these people, they said this horse has to be taken down. So they killed the horse. What are you saying? We've got too many people that's out there living the life with the horse that Absalom rode on, or the mule. They rode upon it. They said, I've got the best thing. They said, I'm going to be able to do okay with it. But the Bible said that way, whichever a tree falls, so shall it lay. If you're on the mule of sin, and you're riding and riding and riding, and you get hung by your head like Absalom did, you know what? Going to happen. That's how you're going to be looked at. That's how you're going to be talked about when you die. So what are you saying? There's a mule out there called sin, and it wants you to get on there. What are you talking about? It's a spirit on them. It's the spirit of rebellion. It's the spirit of lust. It's the spirit of witchcraft. It's the spirit of things trying to get you taken down, to try to make you go down in defeat. But let me tell you something. You don't have to die on the mule of sin. There's a God up in heaven that is willing to pick you up and take you off that mule. But you have to trust in God to get you out. You can't ride on sin after sin after sin and say, I'm going to get right back on. I was thinking when I was sitting on the pew studying, I begin to think about a horse. When you go out, when a little kid first starts trying to ride it, they don't just jump on a horse without nothing to sit on, without I don't remember what it's called right now, but without the saddle. And so when they're on there, they don't just jump on it. Now, experienced one might do that, but a new person will not jump on it. Why? Because they're not trained to hold on. What are you talking about? You can't just jump on the mule of mercy either without any experience. You have to pray. You say, what are you talking about? And get the full armor of God. You say, that don't make any sense. The Bible said, put on the breastplate of righteousness, the helmet of salvation. You said, do all these things. And when you get it on, what are you supposed to do? Just stand. He didn't say, I want you to run out there in the midst and fight. He said, all I want you to do is, he said, I want you to stand. I got all dressed up just to stand here and to stand in the midst of a war. You know what that is? When I was on the mule chair and I was on my way to hell, there was a God that rose up and said, I see you going in the wrong direction. And he picked me up and he turned me around. And I got off the mule headed to hell. And I got picked up and I got put back on the way I needed to go. What are you talking about? There's a mule called mercy. And one night he came down and he helped me go to where I needed to go because of the way I was in sin. That was too deep to go out. But there was a man of God stretched forth the lifeline. And he said, hey, you're going out too far. But he said, I want to pick you up. And he said, I want to pull you in a little bit further. And one night the word of the Lord came unto me. And there was something came over me. And I began to get in the spirit. I began to feel the power of the Lord. I got off the mule headed for hell. And I got turned around and put on the right path.
Yes, sir.
Bless
him,
Jesus.
Amen. So I'm gonna preach.
Yeah.
I begin to think about the mule of sin and where it goes. And I'm not gonna talk about that too long. I want to tell you about the mule of mercy. But I begin to think about the mule of sin, where it leads. It don't just hurt you. It hurts people around you. There was a woman, she told her son, good holiness, a woman, she told her daughter, she said, don't you go out with that boy. He's nothing but trouble. And she said, Mom, no, he loves me. And he said, no, he don't. He just wants one thing out of you. And once he gets it, he'll be done with you. And she said, no, you're wrong. So the mom said, no, you're not allowed to go out. Well, the little girl didn't like her mom's decision, so she took and snuck out the window that night, hopped in the car with that man. And this is a true story. And she went up the road, and they began to drink alcohol. And they were too intoxicated to be driving. And that woman, she said that the little girl and her boyfriend, they were racing up the road, seeing how fast they could get. And they messed up and nailed a car right in the side, killing the people they hurt instantly, killing the people they hit. Now, she wasn't hurt at all. They took her to the hospital just to get her clean. And she was sitting there screaming, somebody go get my mama. Somebody go get my mama. And that nurse said she was just screaming, saying, oh, get my mama. She don't know I'm out here. She thinks I'm at home in bed. And the nurse said, I can't take it no more. They said, what are you going to do? That nurse walked in there and said, honey, you need to stop yelling for your mama. She said, my mama thinks I'm at home. My mom thinks I'm in bed. Someone go get her and pray for me. She said, you don't understand. The person you hit tonight was your mom and dad, killing them. You're on the hellbound train. You're on the mule bound for hell. And you know what's happening? You're not just hurting yourself, but you're hurting the people around you. That little girl at this stage, she's grown now. But she, every day she lives in torment. Every day she lives in the thought, I killed my mom and dad because of what she did, riding the mule bound for sin. But let me tell you about the mercy mule.
Yes, come on, bro.
The mercy mule. You said, what are you talking about? A mule, according to the dictionary, is something that can carry your burden. Stuff that you can't carry yourself.
Yeah.
Most y'all know where I'm going. So they begin to talk about the mercy mule. And I want to give you a real life story before I begin to preach. There was a woman, she owned a field, and she had cows over there. She rode her horse out to the cow, and she said that she seen a little calf over there hurt, laying there bleeding, for it had been attacked. And it said that woman walked over and began to try to help the cow and mend it and the calf. And it said that the mama cow got mad because she thought she hurt her. And the cow walked over and sat on the woman, squishing her. And the horse, not been hollered at or nothing, walked over and began to kick that cow, knocking it off of her. You know what that was? That was that woman's mercy for being killed. You know what I'm talking about? I was squished by sin. I was bound for hell. But there was a man came by and began to kick the legions off of me. He began to kick hell off of me. He began to say, you don't have to die and go to hell, because what he did for me, what are you talking about? It's a man called Jesus. I thought you'd never ask me. He's the God of heaven. He's the God of this earth. If you'll turn to him, it'll be the best decision of your life. For the Bible said, greater is he that is within me than he that is in the world. I'm thankful tonight for all that he's done for me, from where he brought me from where he he said he's going to take me. I begin to think about it. One night in Bethlehem, there was a baby born in a stable. And he was born not to the rich areas, but out in the middle of a field. And he was born, and my purpose was put on his shoulders. Your purpose was put on his shoulders. You know what that was? That was me, him, being prepared for me and you. And 33 years later, he hung and he died for me and you. So we don't have to go to hell. He did that for me. He did that for you. So when you're in the midst of your battle, say, I don't know what I'm going to do. Just remember what Luke chapter number 3 said. It said that the word of the Lord came unto John. I remember the night that the word of the Lord came unto me. Even because the preacher preached and told me about my sins. But he didn't stop there. He told me about a way of escape. He told me that there's a God that said, when I put you in a battle, I'll also bring you out of that battle. You know what that is? That's the mercy mule. That's what he did for me and you. For me and you to have life and have it more abundantly.
Bless him, Jesus. Help him, God.
So, I began to think about Psalms chapter number 3, and I was going to read it, but it said, how is it that my enemies, they are getting more and more and more? They said, how is that? That when the world's coming against me and everybody's getting up on me and beating me down, saying this and saying that, how is it that you're going to allow this, God? But God and the people said, there is no help for you in God. But the Bible said that David looked at them and said, Lord, thou art a shield for me. You know what that is? When they're throwing the darts at you, they're talking about you. They're saying, all you got to do is raise your shield up. How do you get the shield to come down? Just lift your hand up and say, God, you see where I'm in. But David said, he said, save me, oh God. You know what that was? When I was living in sin, I was going the wrong way. There was a man called Jesus, and I cried out, said, God, will you save me from my sins? God, will you bring me out from the place that I'm in? And you say, what are you talking about? So John said, he said, I looked out, and he said, I saw a dove. And he said, it landed up on the shoulder of Jesus. And the Bible said that he said, I bear record. He said, for this is the Son of God. And he said, I heard a voice out of heaven saying, this is my Son, and in whom I am well pleased. He said, not only that, John looked back, and with a bold voice, he went back and he said, behold, the Lamb of God, which taketh away the sin of the world. And there he is standing right there. If you'll turn to him, and you won't give up on the promise, you can ride the mule of mercy all the way to glory. The Bible said, not only did John say that, but the Bible said that John looked down in the midst of heaven, and he said, none was found worthy to open the seals thereof. But he said, I looked back, and he saw, I said, I seen a lamb. He said, that was spotless, that was without blame, that was without no problem with him. And he said, that would be the one to open the seals. And the Bible said, they, the elders, and they would begin to sing the song of Moses.
Amen.
But we got a new song to sing. What is that song? He said, the song of the redeemed. It said, worthy are we been made by the blood of the Lamb. You know what that is? One night he came down from heaven and he was born in a stable. He went to the cross and his blood hit the mercy seat. But he said, I got to go away. And he said, but if you go away, what are we going to do? He said, I'm going to send you a comforter. He said, and when the day of fully crossed, the Pentecost was fully come. It said that the room was filled with cloven tongues of fire. And it said the whole room, it wasn't just Sally over here and Johnny over here, but the whole room began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. And now ever since that day, there's been a Holy Ghost dwelling in us that we can have power and have power over all the enemy of the world, over all the powers of the air. And then he began to talk. And he said, but now there'll be a second of feeling another for me and you. See, we were separated not only from salvation, but we separated from everything, alienated. But by the blood of Jesus, the wall of partition was fell down. And thank God, me and you, we can ride on the mule of mercy. We don't have to go to hell because of what he did for us. David said, I look to the hills which cometh my help. He said, I look to the rock which is mightier than I. And the Bible said, said in Psalms 3, he said that he said, Lord, how is it that this has happened to me? And he said he heard me out of his holy hills. He still got an open ear and he's still willing to listen. He said that for me and you. David said that. And David knows for a fact. David said, I whooped the lion. He said, I whooped the bear. And he said, now I'm going before the Philistine. There's no way that he can do it. He said, there's no way that it's possible. But David stood up with courage and said, hey, there might be a giant out there that you're afraid of. He said, but the Lord is on my side. And God got out there and began to mock him. And he said, you come to me with a spear and a sword. He said, but I come to you in the name of the Lord. There's a name that's above every name. There's a name that if you hold on to when you face your Goliath, it's impossible for a stone to take a kill a giant. But when God is in the midst, it's everything is possible with him. I look to the hills which cometh my help. For my help is in him, and he is my lifter up of my head. The Bible said, lift up your head, O ye gates, and be ye lifted up, ye everlasting doors. And the King of glory is going to come in. They said, who is this King of glory? He said, the Lord strong in battle. Then he said, lift up your head, O ye gates, and be ye lifted up, ye everlasting doors. For the Lord of the God host is going to come in. I believe when Jesus went down to hell and he got the keys from him, I believe Jesus was walking through saying, lift up your head, O ye gates, and be ye lifted up. He looked at death and said, give me the sting. He looked at the grave and said, I'm taking the victory. I'm thankful for what he did for me on the cross of Calvary.